When I am called to duty, God, wherever flames may rage, give me the strength to save a life, whatever be its age. Help me to embrace a little child before it's too late, or save an older person from the horror of that fate. Enable me to be alert, to hear the weakest shout, and quickly and efficiently to put the fire out. I want to fill my calling, to give the best of me, to guard my every neighbour and to protect their property. And if according to your will, I have to lose my life, please bless with your protecting hand my children and my wife.
Well, Christchurch was, as a town, was only 10 years old in November 1860 when they decided that a fire brigade was needed. They had a lot of wooden buildings, they were getting grass fires, and they had no means of combating them. It was 25 local residents under their first superintendent, Joseph Bailey, and it was run more or less like a club or a committee. You know, they voted in their various offices. And the way they ran the organisation. The first fire engine was a manual engine where the firemen pumped the handles up and down on either side to squirt water, and it had a leather hose. This thing was manhandled to fires, it was wooden, and if the hose wasn't long enough, then they would run the engine back as long as the hose was, and then it would have to be bucket brigades that brought the water to the fire engine. And, you know, sometimes they'd carry this fire engine rather than just pull it. And Christchurch had rutted dirt roads and streams running everywhere. That's the sort of machinery they had initially. And some of the businesses contributed, and they got their first uniform, which was a trousers and a tunic with a belt. And the helmets were sort of coal scuttle helmets that were manufactured locally with the letters CVFB on top of them, you know, Christchurch Volunteer Fire Brigade.
The uniforms changed very slowly in the first 100 years, probably. And then they had a massive change in the next 20, with a variety of uniforms being adopted, tried, found to be wanting in some areas, until we've now got the very flashiest, latest Novak-covered machine, which are tremendous protection for the firefighter.
I go into this store and it's full of second-hand clothing. I was kitted out with all this second-hand gear, and it was a really great shock. He gave me a pair of trousers with a red stripe down the side, and said, "You'll grow into those." And that was the sort of tenor of the equipment that I was given. In fact, I was absolutely shocked.
I guess you've got trust in your gear, you've got trust in the kit that you wear, and you've got trust in the firefighters that you work beside. You really go into these incidents without fear.
This fire was a public one. It happened at 3:30 on a normal business day in the centre of Christchurch, and school children were changing buses and trams. It was a shopping day, it was near Carnival week, show week, so it was that time in Christchurch, and this thing developed in front of them, and some of the staff who did lose their lives were screaming and things like this, so it was happening in front of a huge crowd, and there was the perception, and particularly after the Commission of Inquiry too, the fire brigade copped quite a bit of blame.
It was in the aftermath of Ballantyne's. And morale really was low. The firemen were dealt a raw deal. They really were. Yeah, everybody else was represented, but only the firemen. When I say the firemen, Jim Burrows and all the rest of them, they virtually took the blame, and it was misplaced.
It shaped a lot of our national policies and procedures and how we respond to a number of events. It shaped, I suppose, a lot of what we know was the 1975 Fire Service Act introduction and the nationalisation of our organisation. And I think it has really shaped us into the future that we are the single fire service in New Zealand, and that we do strive to always implement national consistency and standards, operating procedures, our resourcing and equipment.
Certainly talking to those firemen, they were all very professional in their era and they did everything they could. I mean, those firemen that had to watch that happen, and they didn't just watch it, they didn't stand and watch it, they put ladders up on balconies and they tried every way to get to those people, but they weren't able to. And to have to take that denigration in the years that followed, I think, and a lot of them joined after Ballantyne's too, so a lot of them were being lambasted for something they had no part in.
So the monument was developed and done in partnership with a number of key agencies, another number of key staff in Christchurch, and it's become a focal point for remembrance and memorial, not just for the 9/11, but to all firefighters that have lost their lives in different events throughout the world.
It was the World Firefighter Games in 2002. That was the reason we had to have a monument or a sculpting, and they were so thrilled that they'd get something representing them on the far side of the world. And many of them come now and bring their families. They love the place and it's a wonderful memorial for them to know it's in a land of peace.
Looking after the family and the home in the first few minutes and sort of, ascertaining what damage had been done. And then realising, because I was the on-duty exec, that, you know, within a very short space of time I did have a job and a role and function that I actually had to fulfil. So for me, that first part of the morning was all about ensuring that I could walk away from a family and home knowing that they were resilient and were in a position that they could cope, so that I could then focus my energies and efforts onto our response, our staff, our resourcing and what we were going to do in terms of supporting the community, and for me personally, supporting both the Mayor, the Emergency Management Officers and my counterparts in police and ambulance in terms of a response to the community.
I was actually on station when it did happen, so there was that instant of, wow, what's going on at home? It's quite scary in thinking that your family and friends are involved in the same incident, but then again, you're there to do a job, so you just move on.
I mean, obviously with all the stuff going on at home as well as what's happening at work, we were on the morning of the earthquake, so it was a really busy time, obviously. A lot of people obviously very scared, so yeah, no, it's been a bit of a blur, to be honest, especially the amount of chimneys that we've been attending to.
When I left home about 5:10, it was still dark and the whole city was sort of dark and the power was just coming back on. So it was an eerie feeling and I wasn't too sure what to expect. I couldn't see much going down the roads and things like that.
I was at home when the earthquake struck and I was due to start work at 8 o'clock, about 4 hours later, 3.5 hours later, so cleaned up my place, lucky I still had power, so I vacuumed up all the broken glass and jumped in the shower and I came in here and I got here about 5 o'clock and did a 24-hour shift and keep coming back when they needed me, and it was not a lot of time spent in this station.
Yeah, first ever. I'd never felt anything like it before. Didn't know what was happening. Stayed in bed for most of it and then got up once I realised what was going on. I didn't realise there was that much destruction either. People just seemed in a little bit of a daze on the day itself. But the days thereafter, people were very appreciative of what you were doing and, yeah, very happy for you to turn up. But everyone was in the same boat. No one knew what was going on.
It's always been in the back of your mind, being in the sort of a job that you'll strike at one day. The most awkward thing was that you'd out there after the quake in a bit of a shock, but casting your mind back to thinking, I hope things are all right at home.
I'm very pleased to say that the Christchurch executive officers especially had insisted a number of civil defence things happened, and they have come to fruition. The plans were laid out. They appear in the instance that I've seen to have worked very, very well. The men themselves were out all day, every day, and with the advent of the urban search and rescue, they have been of tremendous value because they're specially trained to shore up, protect the buildings, get in if they have to see if there's any person that's been trapped in there. But as soon as that object is over, they're in there to make the building safe.
USA was deployed within about 1 hour of the earthquake. The main function, as we said, was to, with the initial deployment of our team in Christchurch, was to get to our base and establish what was damage had been done to the city. It was quite evident early in the piece that we had major structural damage all around Christchurch, so decision was made in Wellington to mobilise both the other teams from the North Island. Auckland and Palmerston North were flown down by military aircraft, and 10 tonne of extra rescue equipment was sent by truck and ship, and that was here by 10 o'clock on Saturday night.
Over the last few days, we've been out doing either building assessments or risk reduction work, taking down chimneys, removing parapets, isolating areas just with cordon tape or paint, indicating hazards to the public.
Normally it would be used as a command and control centre for a significant fire or event. Because of the scale of this event though, currently it's being used as what we would call an emergency operations centre. So we're coordinating the fire services response in Selwyn, Waimak districts, over to Akaroa, throughout the city, and the urban search and rescue response. I think our systems have worked incredibly well. It was never really designed for this scale of emergencies. We do a lot of incident management training though. It is a significant priority for the fire service to train its managers in how to deal with large scale emergencies. And I think there's some, we're getting some reward for that training.
Yeah, when Frank had arrived in Christchurch, he was a new broom sweeping clean. The previous chief had focused very much on buildings and making sure that the city was well protected and covered with the geography of laying out the stations. Frank arrived and decided that he would really shake us up and show us the way that a professional fire brigade should be run. He brought a whole lot of new ideas with him. Having served in the Second World War, he was very much a military man, and we had great respect for him when he arrived. He was with us for quite a number of times and introduced different types of fire engines that were coming up. He got one especially built to his design, etc. And then he was appointed as the Commissioner of the Fire Service. But still in his heart, he had Christchurch and would be always down here for the medal parades and what have you.
I duly presented myself at the fire station. I'm surprisingly interviewed by the chief. And so I've had masses of credentials. I'd passed all sorts of exams. I was really highly qualified. I'd got absolutely top of the line references and passed them all. And he bluntly told me, "These are no good to you." So I said, "Why on earth are they no good?" Well, he said, "If I was going to England to live, you know what I'd do?" I said, "No." He said, "I'd go down to the mayor and I'd get a reference from the mayor." So I said, "Oh, fair enough, but the Lord Mayor and I are not exactly on speaking terms, you know." And anyway, he ranted on in this way, and he was really objectionable. And so in the end, I thought, gee, I'm not going to get a job here, and I've come all this way.
He would probably be the most instrumental in changing the New Zealand Fire Service, along with the amalgamation in 1975 to become the New Zealand Fire Service, of anyone I've ever met. He was an inspiration to us as young firemen and officers.
So in the end he said, "All right, we'll give you a go." And so I said, "Well, how about the entrance examination and so on?" "Oh, you needn't have that. Go to the doctor." So I go to the doctor, Dr. Roberson. He was a fine old man. lived up just off Papanui Road. And so I report to him, and he said, "Were you discharged from the army?" So I said, "You're British Army." "What was your rating?" So I said, "A1. "Oh, you'll do." That was it. The extent of being inducted into the fire service.
I think he relates to the younger people very well. I mean, they probably have a commonality with him. And I think that's good, you know, to have that contrast. We've had older chiefs over the years, and we've had some probably a few years older than him. But it's good to have a really young commander. Dan has also settled things down. We had a period of where management kept moving on. So Dan has had a settling effect on the brigade.
Even probably for the first two or three years, there was no aspirations whatsoever of obtaining the position that I currently have. It was more about enjoying the job, enjoying the challenges, enjoying the people that you met. And that was probably really the focus. It was probably a good 4 years before I thought I could offer more and wanted to do more. My first memories of the recruits course was completely out of my depth, had no idea what I'd actually joined up for, had no idea or comprehension of what I was getting myself into, actually, to be honest. But within a really short space of time, just the camaraderie that started coming through with everybody that was in the same boat, and we're all keen to learn and all keen to sort of be tested, being thrown into new and different things.
It is a world-class organisation, and there can be no doubt about that in anybody's mind. And it is the result of good and effective training. There have been differences of opinion over the years about training, but now you look at the finished product and they turn in a really good performance on every occasion. You look at the way the fireman of today, firefighter of today, conducts himself. He's not a different man, but he's in a better position to do a better job than ever his predecessors were.
Yeah, it's a good feeling. It's knowing that someone's needing help and that they've decided to call us for help is a good feeling. It makes me feel like the training that I did was, people were appreciating the training which we went through, and yeah, it's quite a rush.
People, you know, can be fearful in those situations, but I think that if you're given the right training, if you've got the right equipment with you, I guess that knowledge of what to do and the tools that you've got with you just help make that things, you know, make things much easier in that situation.
So we're really looking forward to this. We've heard that you've been rehearsing things, and if we can, we'll try and sing along as well. Voices are a wee bit croaky this morning, but that we're really looking forward to it.
Some people have been burnt on the jobs and that over the years and that. Not too seriously, but you know, do come back from an incident where they've had their elbows or their knees and that. So you're on occasions.
I've got that one.
Are you scared?
Do you ever get scared?
Yes, I definitely, I'll speak for myself, I definitely get scared. I haven't been in the job as long as some of these guys, so maybe they don't get as scared as I do, but being honest, yep, sometimes we do. We get into some fairly scary situations.
They're generally like most doing is coming to have a look at the fire engine and having a squirt on the hoses.
We have had very, very good support from the Fire Service Commission. Should there be a model that comes off that we really want, they tend to direct it our way. And then it goes into our restoration area where it's either painted up, titivated up, cleaned up and brought into the museum. We work a great working bee at least once a week over in the restoration area. Then there's cleanups a regular basis through here, and then we're open on a variety of special days and the first Sunday of every month. We can't afford, unfortunately, to be open all the time because of the demands on volunteer services. This is the biggest museum in the Southern Hemisphere for fire engines. Originally starting here in Christchurch at the old Litchfield Street Station in a dormitory type set up, which was very, very good for companionship. And then we moved around, I'm fairly sure it's about 1962, to the new station, which had wonderful facilities.
Oh, there's certain aspects to life on the trucks from a management role that certainly I do miss. There's certainly a lot more camaraderie and a real close bond with your crew and the things that you get up to. Something like living with people, you know, sleeping on station, having meals together, sort of that breaking of the bread sort of environment creates a really close bond.
As a new firefighter, the comradeship and mateship's great. There's a great social life outside of the fire service.
Life as a firefighter, I guess, is just an extended family, the camaraderie that goes on.
Christchurch is my brigade, and I returned back here in 1982, and stayed until I retired.
When I joined the fire service, they really stressed the need for teamwork and camaraderie, and I guess over the last fortnight, I've actually really seen that come through.
It's the greatest organisation you could possibly join. You've joined a camaraderie of wonderful people.
I've been in the fire service for 31 years.
I'm one of those people that got the bug of wanting to be a fireman when I was very young, and it never went away.
One of the probably the main reason I enjoy about being a firefighter, or why I wanted to become a firefighter, was that it was an honourable position. It was something that not only myself but my family could be proud of.
And what came out with this earthquake was that the work ethic of all the firefighters out there was unbelievable. As I said before, the hardest part was getting them home at night time.
Nobody could ever wish for a better life than I had. I started right at the bottom, and you couldn't go any further up the top. And for every grade I went through, I met the most marvellous people right throughout the country. A fantastic job, fantastic career. And I look back with a great deal of pleasure and a lot of pride, I might say, because every time I look at a fire appliance, I can see what I did, and I did it well.
Protecting hand is watching over still.